pieces that have to fit together. Whereas I can do a funny thing that Pinky says, or a funny thing that Rarity says, or even a funny thing that Spike says, but when you're writing for Twilight, you have to sort of keep the story in mind.
Stupid story.
I mean, not that she can't be funny.
No, she can be funny, but often that's not what she's doing. Right. And like in Rainbow Dash, it was, you know, she was being a teacher, and it was challenging to make sure that she had some funny moments because she was being very, you know, authoritative. But in that way, she was funny because she was being always authoritative.
Can you guys hear him out there? A little sound. Okay. Lord, you have to speak closer to the microphone.
What about now? Is that good?
Yeah.
Right. Right in there. Gonna do NPR style, just really close, really soft tones.
Amy just revealed all the plots for season 5. You didn't hear that? That's the greatest cosplay, by the way.
I don't know what just happened. Everyone just needs to get as close to the mics as possible, I guess. Okay, a traditional line of wisdom from many writers and seasoned journalists is to write while drinking and edit while sober. Emmy Larson once spilled an entire bottle of tequila on his laptop and had to dry it out in rice. What are your preferred tools and methods for inspiration and motivation?
I think yours is answered.
Yes, you are doing it.
Yeah.
Deadlines, basically. That's, that's kind of it.
Sweet, sweet checks.
I think it's, the element of, I don't even know if I'm answering what you asked me.
Just what are your tools and methods of inspiration?
I think it's just trying to like...
Yeah,
I need a break. It's just trying to surprise myself, I guess. Like, whenever I sit down to write an episode, the only way it's going to be interesting is if I can try to find ways that I'm like, oh, that, I didn't expect that to happen. So I guess it's that, maybe.
Mine's candy. Straight up candy.
Twizzlers.
Twizzlers, Swedish fish, jelly beans. I kind of have a problem.
Rushed by the end, and you know, I just try and accomplish the things and come up with things that are funny, so that I just plot it out so that then I can think and percolate later.
I don't really have an inspirational thing. The motivation thing, I I definitely need, but I have like crazy characters talking to each other in my head all the time, and I have to corral them or sit on the sofa and stare at the wall. Like, the motivation is important because I have to pay my mortgage. So I have to corral them and direct them towards the appropriate end. So, yeah, I definitely... Deadlines and bills, man. They're a great motivation.
Mentioning your mortgage.
It weighs heavy.
Maybe you have a really high mortgage.
Maybe no. Really weighs on me.
This
morning?
You can't really plan inspiration, I don't think. But I have, like, jokes will come into my head or lines of dialogue that I will write.
No, something else.
Yes.
But I'm hilarious, Megan. So, yeah. That's my second welcome.
Everyone is just so awake up here. I don't know if this stuff's going to cut it. Somebody get some coffee, I don't know. How often, percentage-wise, are you presented with a specific task or product by Hasbro and told to create a story around it? How challenging is that?
Are we allowed to answer that?
It's not so much told as ordered.
If everyone could just not get upset when that's clear, if that happens, that would be nice.
I think people think that it's a large percentage, but it's actually a really small percentage. I can't give an exact, 20.2%. But yeah, it's not as much. I mean, I think people are like, oh, you have to do this. A lot of times it's just like, no, we just want that to be fun.
I think if there's something in the show that you don't like, it's because we had to do it for a time.
Right.
Alright, my phone is just blowing up and I'm going to have a full-blown mutiny if I don't ask the question, will the Cutie Mark Crusaders ever get their cutie marks, or will they keep crusading after they do so? The answer is they can't answer this, but let's just give it a shot.
The who now?
Cutie Mark Crusaders.
Yes, they're going to get him really soon, and then they're going to lose him, and then get him again.
Can you give him to other people?
And then they're going to become Alphonse.
Yeah. And one last one that I thought was already answered, but apparently people watching the stream don't think so. Do you all hate Spike?
Yes.
Spike abuse!
He's like your little brother. I mean, you love him, but you also really hate him.
We don't like working with Kathy.
Yeah. Spike's never going to be his cutie mark either.
All right, well, I don't want to take up all the time, so I guess if we want to have the Q&A, we can start that up now. I don't know where there's a microphone. Is there one? Over there?
Ask easy questions.
You got one that doesn't work over here.
Yeah, let's use that microphone.
Over here? Sorry.
Okay, yeah, it is.
A little. To be fair, they forced us into it. We're being snarky, but you made us this way.
I'm okay.
They made us stay out late.
That's good. That's fine.
Oh, sorry. Oh, this is my bad.
Alright, so, what do you think Spike's character is?
Because it really seems like none of you guys seem to be agreed upon on who he is. I mean, sometimes he's shown as like a actual character, a little bit, you know, sarcastic, immature, greedy, what have you, but has a cool talk underneath. Or sometimes he seems like almost a little incompetent sometimes, you know? And it kind of bounces around a little bit. So, kind of wondering, are we going to see a little bit more of like him developing more as a character, maybe?
He has two really good episodes coming up in the next couple weeks. But I think I think of him as a kid, and he's kind of still figuring out who he is, and especially in relation to the main six. I mean, they're older than he is. Just they're the big kids, and he's the little kid. So that's kind of how I think of him and how I approach him. And so he's going to make mistakes and do some things that some of the more mature characters wouldn't do. I like him.
We're joking. We like Spike.
Yeah, they're being silly.
I never even joked about it. I just said I love him.
But yeah, he does have some good stuff coming up.
He has some really cool stuff coming up.
That Kathy just took to another level.
I have a question. So, I've heard rumors that there's going to be like a Princess Skyla. I was wondering if there is going to be one, because I just really...
The question is Princess Skyla real?
Yeah.
She's a toy that exists, but that's the extent of it as far as I know.
Can you tell us about failed pitches, stories that will never be? Maybe some of your favorite ideas that just aren't going to happen and you're bummed out about, and this is where you can release them.
That list is so long.
I was trying to think of something you guys could roll with for a little while.
Actually, a couple of mine ended up in some of the passages of the Journal of the Two Sisters and the Journal of Friendship, because I was so bummed that they didn't end up as episodes. I made them journal passages. So, you know, that's how I was like, ah! I was just so sad. So that's how I made them come alive. So you can read them. Where you buy my book.
Amazon.com.
But other failed ones, I'm trying to think of ones that
I had one that I could never really figure out, but I wanted to feature like a friendship between Luna and Applejack. And the only scene I had in mind was like them at the beach together. That was it. That was all. I couldn't make 22 minutes out of that.
I feel like you have to have so many ideas all the time and have a really sort of thick skin about letting them go immediately because they're not going to work, or Megan doesn't like them, or... I mean, that's like part of the process is just pitching everything you can think of to find the show that works. So I have a horrible memory for ones that didn't fly because I immediately let them go and move on to the one that I had to work on.
I was just going to say, or you can never let them go and just keep pitching them
all
and so I can't tell you
them
because,
ways.
Yeah, maybe she'll agree to it at some point.
Oh, I love when people do that.
I can tell, so.
Thank you.
Guten Tag. This question is for Emil Larsson. Earlier this year, you picked up this wonderful scarf at Hasbro Studios. Why were you actually there?
At Hasbro Studios?
Yes.
I was trying to do like a hostile takeover. I can't remember those.
Okay, thank you.
It was a Chuck the Chuck reboot.
Hi. I was wondering, who are your favorite characters to write for as a pair?
Pair?
Yes,
sir.
There are a couple of good pairs. I definitely like the Rarity Applejack pairing that I did in Simple Ways. Like, just because they're such opposites, what a great, that was a great episode to write because you got to play off these two people who are, these two ponies who are not anything alike. And obviously Applejack and Rainbow Dash are a great pairing to write for. Like, their storyline in Castlemania was so entertaining because they play off each other so well. I think those are my two favorites.
I agree that Rarity and Applejack are fun ones to pair up because they are, they're so different. And that's fun to watch them navigate because they're still friends. And it's kind of a reflection of how real friendships are, where you can have friends that are really different than you, and how do you find that common ground and what keeps you hanging out? So I like them too.
Lyra and Bon Bon.
I had fun with Rainbow Dash and Twilight. That was a fun combo that I don't think had been really explored before.
Thank you.
Hi. I was just wondering, are there any plots or ideas that you come across in all the years of writing this now that were basically something you really would like to do or think would be interesting, but were too serious considering that the target demo is, of course, a children's show?
It's like a methadone addiction to start over.
Yeah. Well, you keep pitching over and over again, yet sounds familiar. we had one that we thought, can we kind of do this, and it was a little too serious. We kind of hinted at elements of it, but didn't feel like we could do it and not make people cry. But I think we handled some pretty, you know. Obviously, the show is funny and silly, but I think we do handle some topics that are a little bit serious sometimes. But, you know, we're not going to straight up murder anybody.
Howdy. I was at the writing panel yesterday, and from what I gathered, you actually write the episodes individually and have the occasional writer summit to kind of sync up and make sure same headspace. So I'm curious if, this being a bit like your freelance work that you've probably done, do you find it, like, what do you like and dislike about this model? Is it different from other shows? Do you find it's easier to write because no one's breathing down your neck, or harder because it's harder to make continuity nods or know exactly what happened in the previous episode?
They're still breathing down your neck. It's just email.
I mean, I would prefer that we had an actual writer's room, but some people in the world don't want to pay for that. So, no one here. We would all love to be in a room every day together. But even on a show where you have a writer's room, when you get your episode, you still go off and write it at home and whatever. And we sort of approximate that with our summits, and then we'll come in and break story, like in pairs or whatever.
I will say the continuity thing doesn't bother me sometimes, just because I don't always know what's happened or what happened or what other people wrote. So you don't know if you're repeating. I mean, obviously Megan, we wouldn't repeat, Megan wouldn't let us repeat anything, but as I'm writing it, I don't know.
Yeah, I run into that. I get the occasional note where they're like, oh, I think you said this. Different joke.
Yeah, it would be lovely to be a group and have a writer's room and be in-house. That's how it was back when I was at Cartoon Network. And if, when you're in-house, you tend to write scripts either in the studio. Sometimes you do go home, but to have a writer's room. And then what you do is then you would come in and read each other's scripts, and then you hear each script and go, oh, that's what happened with my Twitter thread, all that kind of stuff. And that would be really, really lovely. Because then we'd know everything that was going on as we're going along with each other. And that would be really, really fantastic. But I think considering we don't have that, and the show is, the writing and the show is so strong, I think it's pretty amazing that the show continues to be as strong as it is when we aren't hanging out with each other all the time.
Thank you very much. I was wondering how important the puns are to the show. Is it just something that talking animal shows do, or does that come from you guys? The horse buns.
I think they're very important.
Yeah. It's what's holding the whole show together.
Lunch and puns
are the two most important things.
We wouldn't have episode titles without puns.
When we had a summit, we went through a run where we were just writing puns up on the board, like pun titles. I'm trying to think what we had. We had like Applejack Reacher.
Right.
We just like wrote that along
the
board. Down to an apple. Yeah, we just wrote a bunch of. All right, no, you know what? I think it was. I think I left the room to go because I had to go talk to somebody. And when I came back, I believe this was what had happened while I was gone.
Not only would we not have episode titles, we wouldn't have names of cities or towns.
Yeah.
So it'd be a really boring world without puns.
Trying to keep things simple, favorite song from the show, My Little Pony.
Best night ever.
Can I pick one that I wrote? Yeah. Is that bad? The one that I enjoyed writing the most was This Day Aria. That one was really fun. And then there's another one coming up that when I sort of arrived at what the kind of chorus that it was going to be, I was like, oh my gosh, this is really cool.
I met at the gala.
Wait, what?
Smile song.
Yeah.
I like Natasha's song. What was it? Apples to the Core. That is catchy.
Thank you.
Student at San Francisco State University, a creative writing major, and I was curious, wondering if there are any literary works that have had a significant impact on you, or given you some sort of inspiration of any kind, anything from Keats, Wordsworth, Milton, Yeats, Austin, or Melba, that kind of nature? Anything, I was just giving some examples.
To Kill a Mockingbird.
Yeah. Oh yeah, yeah. Both of our children, they're named after us.
I like Vonnegut, John Steinbeck, J.K. Rowling.
Yeah.
Yeah, I lean on Douglas Adams.
Works of Natasha Levitin.
My eighth grade journals. There's some really good poetry in there, guys.
What was your guys' favorite episode to make?
Fun on most of the ones that I've written. I liked the stories and liked what I was able to get away with in some of them.
I would probably say the Super Speed Sarah Squid 6000 because I get to watch the Music Man and write the song. And those characters are so fun. So that was a good time. And I didn't have to worry about a lesson.
Testing, testing, 1, 2, 3, kind of fell together really. really, really nicely, and felt like kind of a throwback to season one, and the message of it was something that was very true to my heart. So, like, overall, just I really enjoyed that writing that episode.
Well, I've only done two so far, so I don't want to.
You have to, though. That's the question.
I
have to
pick.
I've only done three, and I've enjoyed them all. Much more than anyone else's. But actually, the most fun to write was the first one, because everything was new, and it was exciting, and now it's
now
not.
It's terrible.
No. Because it was like this whole sort of Scooby-Doo thing, and it was a lot of fun.
Thank you.
What's it like watching an episode that you wrote, and how is it different than watching an episode that you know someone else wrote?
Narcissism.
One feels really, really awesome, and the other's like, meh.
One is like, I did that, and the other's like, oh, who did that? Okay.
Well, I was going to say something that's kind of, because it's the animation, because the time from when we write the script to when the episode airs, it's kind of nice that there's this big, long gap, because by the time it airs, you've kind of forgotten if there was like horribleness when you were working on it. Like the pain of it is kind of gone, or the things that you kind of, that drove you crazy, you've kind of forgotten about it. So I feel like you can watch the episode and enjoy it for actually being this full episode. Because I've done things where I was in film school and you would write a short, and then you would make it, and it would be done, and I could never watch the short and see the movie. I could only see the individual scenes, and I was reciting the dialogue outside, you know, in my head as they were saying it. So I could never see this full thing. And with animation, it's nice because I can see an episode 8 months after I wrote it, and I'm not reciting all the lines in my head. I'm just enjoying it play out as an audience member.
It's super fun, like, back to Super Speedy Side of Squeezy, like, to see that song, to hear it as a song, and then to see all the animation they did and the dance number that was going on and everything. It's really cool to have that experience. Way cooler than watching, like, one of their episodes.
like watching one of my Flim Flam episodes. Probably a lot cooler. I feel the same way.
Yeah, watching somebody else's episode, I go, oh, that's what they did with the character. That's cool, and you learn something, and that's awesome. Watching your own episode, it's, one, you go, oh, that's really funny. Did I write that? Oh, I'm so funny. And then it's like, it's just very exciting, and your heart races, and it's this very exciting experience. And then, so it's just a very, you know, uplifting, hopefully, experience for you. Whereas the other is you're watching another episode of The Pony and you're watching it, and that's cool too.
Sometimes it's aggravating to watch someone else's episode because you can't help thinking, like, why didn't I think of that? Oh. So there's some regret and jealousy.
Do you ever have to work with the animators to make sure that they knew what the line was for the episode?
Are any of them here?
Yeah, I was just going to say. Jason or Jim?
How really can know? We are, all the writing staff is actually based in LA, in Los Angeles, and all the animation team is all in Vancouver. So we're never in the same building together. So certainly I have back and forth via email about stuff, but also I know when we turn in a script, they're just gonna make it awesome, so it's pretty rare that we need to have that kind of back and forth and me telling them, do this, they're gonna do it and make it great.
To make suggestions.
Yeah. Yeah, they're gonna do their own thing. It's always amazing. So.
Is it okay if I record this?
Yeah.
Sure. Mom? Are you guys ever going to make more Doctor Who references?
Doctor Who references? Probably.
Thank you.
Hello, I'm Leo Silva. My question is rather long, but it's relevant to what you're doing. So please pay attention. While thinking about the future of the Furious in the long run, I think it's going to last for future years to come. And I believe that you make most of your writing decisions per season, one season at a time. So one issue that I think is worth thinking about, I like to point out to you, a balance between two things. You understand that the characters have to be flawed in order to be interesting. For example, Florsha expressing herself in a humble manner and Pinkie Pie accidentally annoying the crap out of everybody. But also, in pretty much any story, especially in a story like My Little Pony, in which the lesson of the day is highlighted at the end of the day, we expect to see some kind of character progression. The characters to evolve and change their behavior over time. So, I was wondering, I really don't mean to be critical, for the sake of constructive criticism, it's just that whenever you see, let's say, Photoshop, it's still being a doormat when she has supposedly learned to express yourself aggressively. So my question is, do you have a plan or a strategy in order to balance the progression of the characters and making sure that they don't become perfect and flawless, because everybody knows that flawless characters are the most boring thing in the world. So I just was thinking, in the long run, how would you manage not keeping your characters flawed while still showing that they have learned from their mistakes.
That's a really hard thing to do.
I think Laura built those flaws into the characters, so you can't really eradicate them. It's inherent in them. So, I don't know, it just feels like it's already in them, you know?
It kind of goes back to the thing you're talking about, being like a sitcom and how it resets every episode. Like, his characters, these characters that are archetypes and have these inherent flaws that really don't change, but then every episode they learn something. Usually the thing they learn is not something that changes them as a character. It's more something that for the audience to learn from the example that they've set. But in order to have a show, you have to have characters that everyone recognizes, and those characters themselves